الله الرحمن الرحيم.
يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا.
شراب الحب يعرف بالمذاق وما كل السقاط له بساق شراب الحب.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير هدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وبعد. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Just reiterate, like the brother said, a big jazakumullah khair to each and every one of you for attending today. I think it's almost sub-zero out there, isn't it? So subhanallah. So inshallah ta'ala, may Allah increase your hasanat on your scale for yawm al-qiyamah. Ameen. As for the topic the brother has asked me to speak about today, it is called the sunnah of marriage. The sunnah meaning the tradition of marriage. I know that as Muslims, when we hear the word sunnah, straight away we attribute it to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said that I leave you two things behind. If you were to hold on to these two things, you would never go astray. And that is the Kitabullah, the Book of Allah, wa sunnati. And he said, my sunnah, my tradition. So inshallah ta'ala, the topic is the sunnah of marriage. And inshallah ta'ala, we're going to give the tradition of marriage according to Al-Islam. Now, that is not to say that it is a tradition which is only associated with Al-Islam. As we know that the oldest tradition in the history of man is what? Marriage, is it not? It is the oldest tradition that you can find. I tried to wrap my brain a little bit and to think, could there be something else? And I said, no. Because when you open the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, the Quran, after Allah describes the sifat, which is the characteristic of humans, some are believers, some are disbelievers, and some are hypocritical. Allah goes straight into a story. What is that story? The first story you find in the book of Allah, the Quran, talks about who? Adam and Eve. Adam alayhi salam. And Allah, he said, Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. Allah said, verily I'm going to create my khalifa on the earth. Then Allah said, Ya Adam, uskun anta wa zawjika fil jannah. In that same Safa, the page of the Quran, for those who have memorized it or read it, you find in the beginning of that, Allah talks about, I'm going to create Adam. And whilst talking about creating Adam, the angels are arguing back with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in amongst that, the Satan is told also to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. All on the same page. We find this is the creation of mankind, is it not? And then straight after they said, Allah said, oh Adam, you and your wife go and dwell in paradise. So after all of that conflict's over, Allah says, Adam and Eve, you go and dwell in paradise. So the story behind this is that Adam alayhi salam, after he was created, he was lying and he was asleep one day in paradise. I mean, he'd just been created, he's lying in paradise and so on. And then he wakes one day to find a woman in front of him. And he said, the narrator says that he is pleasantly surprised. I mean, he's pleased with what he sees. So he says, who are you? She says, I am Hawa. Where did you come from? I mean, he's the only human, yes? He's never seen another human before. And he sees another human, but mashallah, very pleasing. Where did you come from? He says, Allah created me from your rib. Why are you here? Adam says, why are you here? Hawa said, Allah saw that you was lonely and you needed a companion. And that's why Allah sent me. Subhanallah. So who conducted that nikah? Who was the first person to conduct the nikah? Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam and then his mate. And that's why Allah says, Ya Adam, uskun anta wa zawjaka fil jannah. You and your wife. The word used is zawj. Those in Arabic know this means spouse. Zawja is the wife. So Allah says in the divine text, I created man, who is Adam, and his wife. So you can see this is from the greatest and the oldest of tradition. And that's why marriage is something that if you study history, I mean, I don't know if you like to read history, but we were bombarded with history as we grew up through school days, was we not? I mean, I studied the lives of Incas in Peru and Aztecs in Mexico and so on. And even if you watch the old cowboys and Indian films, what do you find? The chief, yes? What does he say with the chief? When the white man comes, and no disrespect to anybody who's of white skin, but this is how they showed it. When the white man comes and says, look, wife number one, wife number two, wife number three. So marriage is a tradition. It's not something that man took and said, it's a civilized way of doing it. No, everyone used to do this. It's a tradition from the time of Adam alayhi salam. So it's a very old tradition. And that's why Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, Ya ayyuha an-nas ittaqu rabbukum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida wa khalaqa minha zawjaha. Oh mankind, Allah reminds you. He doesn't say, oh believers, oh mankind, verily we created from one soul. And from that soul came what? The wife, the mate came. وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. And from that came all of the other men and women. Okay? So just me speaking about those points alone, we can see two lessons we can take immediately. Two lessons we can take immediately. And those two lessons are enough today for us to understand the purpose behind marriage. Whether from the time of Adam alayhi salam, or whether what is established in the Sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. First and foremost, human beings, we are a social being. Our nature is that we like to socialize. We like to meet people, we like to talk to people, we like to get to know people. Isn't this the case? We like to get out and about. I know with the advent of technology, we brought the social media, everything into our household. But I'm telling you, after a few hours of tapping away on the computer and networking people, you may get some enjoyment, but it's nothing like going out and being with the ikhwan, yes? With the brothers, over a kebab, yeah? Nothing like it. There's nothing like it. That's because we are a social being. And then once we've enjoyed that time with the brothers, isn't it nice for us to come back and then speak to our wives? And she's got kebab ready for you as well. We're social beings, so enjoy time with the brothers, and we enjoy time with our wife. But if we're constantly at home with our wives, then our wives will get annoyed with us. Okay? And we get annoyed with our wives and so on. So we're social beings, which means we like to go and meet people, we like to talk, we like to go on about our experiences. Is this not the case? So that's one of the first things. Allah saw in Adam alayhi salam, after he was created, he has a need. What is the need? To have some sort of enjoyment, company. That's why one of the things that the scholars said that marriage is about is tamattu. Tamattu is enjoyment. Enjoyment comes in many ways, physical, emotional, psychologically. There's many different ways that people enjoy each other's company. So that is one of the reasons they said marriage is important, because of this aspect that people need to gain this enjoyment in life. And then the scholar said the second reason, and they almost put a full stop at the end of this, is manfa. The reason people get married is so they can have this social interaction, enjoy each other's company, but they want to see some product from this, some benefit from this, and that is children. I mean, those of you who are parents here, you know, you try to remember back to a time before you had children. It's very difficult for you. Though you enjoyed the time with your partner, let's say your spouse, whether it be your husband or your wife, you enjoyed that time. I mean, they call it the honeymoon period, don't they? Straight after. That year goes so excellent, it's unbelievable. You are on cloud nine, brothers. Yes, mashallah. And you think there's no other feeling like this. The mashallah, but when you have your first child, what happens? Oh, it's a different experience altogether. You actually enjoy that. And then you have more children, what happens? Mashallah. Then we go back to the old scenario, the king of Siam. Son number one, son number two. Some people start boasting. Boast about women, wives, and boast about children. Why? Because this is the nature of mankind. The fitrah. This is the nature of mankind. Zuina linnas hubba shahwati minan nisa'i wal bani. Who is saying this? Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying this. Zuina linnas. We made beautiful for mankind. Hubba shahwat. The desire for nisa. To have women and to have children. Bani. And it goes on to talk about gold, silver, trade, and so many things. But can you see, the nature of man, who knows better than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that's why Allah, He made it an institution almost. The man, he needs to marry, and if he marries, he will get benefit, both from a social point of view, and also from a point of view of the fact that he will leave things that will, as they say, quratul ayn, is like a pleasing of the eye. Many of us, what do we find? We enjoyed our marriage, but then we live our lives almost for our children again, do we not? So there is an enjoyment in all of this. And all when you do it in a halal manner. All when you do it in accordance to marriage. So that's why the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that I leave you two things behind. If you follow this, then what will happen? Never be misguided. And so from amongst his sunnah is what? Is the marriage. As the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَتَزَوْجُ النِّسَىٰ فَمَنْ رَكِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. From my sunnah is that I marry women. And whoever leaves this sunnah is not from me. Now this is a serious statement, this is not. It is a very serious statement. When Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي is not from me, means well, who are you from then? Don't you want to be from the Ummah Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? So you can see why Islam heavily emphasizes marriage. So now the question is, when we say a sunnah, a tradition, and we said the tradition is to marry, and we said even when it comes to the issue of Adam and Eve, we said it was Allah who conducted that contract. I mean, there was nothing there for us to see. There was no witnesses, no wali amr, no none of this that we have. But it's a tradition that was set, yes? So what is this tradition according to the Ummah Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the Sharia of Al-Islam? First, we need to understand what we have and the beauty of Al-Islam. We need to appreciate what the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came and found and he reformed. To see what he came and reformed. Because Islam doesn't come and bulldoze its way through everything. Islam doesn't come as a religion and say to a people, you can't speak a certain language. We kill off all languages. Or you can't eat a certain type of food. We kill off all types of food. Or you can only wear a certain cloth. Though many people think, yes, we have to speak Arabic, and we have to have kuf there, and so on. We have to have all of this, and we have to wear a thobe. Many people think that is Islam. No, that is one aspect of feeling brotherhood and so on, enjoying beauty from the spread of Islam from different parts of the world. But that in itself is not Islam. Islam doesn't come and say to a person, change these things. No. If you're from a certain area, you keep your language. You keep your type of food as long as it's thought in the right manner, it's halal. You keep the clothing that you have as long as it covers the requirements of awrah, covering the awrah. You keep all of these things. So Islam does then exactly the same thing when it came to marriage. If you found something good in the people, then Islam wouldn't change it. But when you found something bad in the people, then it changed. That's called Islah, reformation. So just like nowadays, do we find people have mixed opinions about the type of marriage that they want? See, some people like to get married in a church. Do they not? Some people like to get married in a church, and there's a certain image to how that wedding should be. Likewise, some people, like in the Muslim community, have to get married in a mosque. Other people, they're happy just civil registration, which is go to an office and get registered and so on. And then other people, they have other arguments as well. So the issue is, what is it that people want from marriage? And what is it that Islam says that the relationship should be? Well, if you look to the time of the Prophet ﷺ came and found men and women, they were living together, and they had a loose version of what marriage is. One of them was, as we know it, man and wife. A contract between two people only. Okay, even when a man marries more than once, two, three times, see, he can't marry in the same contract. He can't say, I married two women at the same time and put it in the same contract. No, the contract is an individual thing between that man and that woman. So it's usually one man, one woman. And this used to exist in the Arabian Peninsula. Another type of marriage, and obviously just to show you how evil society can get, was where a woman, she would be married to a man similar like this, a contract, but this man would send his wife off to another man, someone of nobility or so on, and he would wait to the point she had conceived with that man and then bring that woman back. That's called marriage in the Arabian Peninsula at that time. Because he wanted to have some noble blood there, but still claim it as his. So this was a type of marriage. There was another type of marriage where a woman, she would be shared amongst 10 men. I mean, that's the maximum limit. I mean, she is shared amongst 10 men. And then when she falls pregnant, what will happen? She would point to any one of those 10 men that she wants, because she's married to all of them. And she would say, you are the father. Now, it doesn't matter whether this child resembles the father or anything. No. It's you are the father and you have to do the upkeeping. And this is accepted in that society. And the other type and the last type was a woman. She would sleep with as many men as possible. And it doesn't matter. And then when the child was born, she would go to someone who is a seer, as they say. They would do lots of things to find out who is this child from and so on. And it could be this woman slept with anyone in society. And if she brought this child to that person and this other person was a witness, and this person said, look, this child is yours, this person would have to accept it. That is how marriage was. That is how relationship was. So you can see from amongst all of that we find, what did Islam do? Islam said we only keep the one which is a contract between one man, one woman, keep it holy between them and until death do us part. That is a type of contract. And Islam said this is the only one we recognize. So all the others became what? Batil, became something rejected. So it's important for us to understand that Islam gives so much importance to marriage and it respects marriages done upon contracts like that. So when we look to the Christian contract in marriage, what is it, more than one man? Is it more than one woman? How is it? One man, one wife. Okay. So you can see this is similar to the way we have. Even in Judaism, it is one man, one woman, man and wife, yes? So Islam even recognizes the validity of those marriages as well, because if those people were to become Muslim after being Christians, after being from the Judaic religion, if they were to come into al-Islam, Islam doesn't say to them, get married again. Islam says your marriage is still valid, subhanAllah. Why? Because it's based on the same principle, isn't it? That you're exclusive to each other. You have a contract with each other. So Islam says to these people, no, we don't ask you to marry again. Because what are you going to? You're going to go through the same process, the same values. You're just going to reiterate them. So Islam says, no. Whereas Islam says to people that are boyfriend and girlfriend, and then they come into al-Islam, Islam says, no, you need to solidify that relationship. You need to make it halal. Alhamdulillah, mashallah, we are pleased you become Muslim. We're very pleased, mashallah. You're our brother and you're our sister, mashallah. Allahu Akbar, yes? But solidify it. There's a contract. Because this contract carries a lot of weight. Because we're going to explain the sunnah. What does the sunnah do? We said the sunnah keeps you guided. It protects you. Hold on to the book of Allah, hold on to the sunnah, the messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It will guide you and it will protect you. Protect you from the fitna in the dunya as well as the wrath of Allah, yawmul qiyamah. Because some of the severest punishments are for who? People who like to fornicate, to do adultery, people who do these sort of things. Some of the most severest of punishment are reserved for these people. And that's why the Sahaba, they were amazed on one occasion, when they were speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, you know, the rich people, they run away with all of the goodness. These are the poorer companions. They've gone away with all of the goodness. What is left for us? Meaning the rich people, they can give left, right and center without to even count because they have so much money. And obviously we know that this is rewarded multifold. So the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do you not have a good word? Kalimat tayyiba, do you not have a good word? Yes. This is like sadaqah, this is like a charity. So the Rasul said, when you smile to your Muslim brother, it's like charity. And even when you go home and cohabit, sleep with your wife, charity. The Sahaba, they understood the issue about the good word. They understood the issue about smiling. I mean, this is from goodness, isn't it? But they even had a good thought when it came to the last point. You sleep with your wife, which is something you would do anyway, and that is charity. Said, Ya Rasulullah, how can this be? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, would it not be that you would be punished if you were to do this with other than your wife? I mean, any other woman you were to go to sleep, would you not be punished by Allah? They said, yes. That is how you are rewarded. The fact that because you do something just halal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah doesn't punish you for it. Rather, what you do becomes obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Becomes something that makes you worthy of hasanah, goodness, reward. So now the question becomes, what is the purpose behind marrying and so on? Because there's a famous hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, and who's single here? Any single brothers here? Just slightly. Okay, don't let... Okay. Sisters, have a good look over the barrier, inshallah. These are the single brothers here today. I can be your wali, inshallah. But the single brothers, listen to what Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. He said, let the young marry if they can. Because it will do two things. What will it do? Lower their gaze. Okay? If the youth, they marry, it will lower their gaze and it will protect their private parts. But if he's not able to do that, then what? فَعَلَيْهِ siyam or صَوْمُ. If he's not able to do that, then this young person, then what should he do? He should fast. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, get married in a young age because the fitna you're faced with is two things. Firstly, is lowering your gaze. Very difficult. Because by fitna, you're going to look. Remember I mentioned Adam and Eve? The first thing the narrator says is that when Adam saw Eve, he was pleased. He didn't even say a thing. He thought, mashallah. Now this is the fitrah. This is what Allah is going to put in each and every one of us. Mashallah. You look at each other. So this becomes very difficult. This becomes very difficult for the brothers who are single to lower their gaze. Which means if you can't lower your gaze, because your eyes, they're like a doorway to your heart. That's why you have to protect your eyes from what you see and so on. So because it opens up a doorway to your heart and you long and you yearn for something like this. So you have to be careful. So then what will happen? Some people will lead them into doing the fahisha, which is the illicit relationship. And may Allah save us from this. Ameen. So the whole purpose of marriage is to lower your gaze and to protect your private parts. Because if you don't, what will happen? You're sinful for looking and you're also sinful for doing an haram act with someone that you shouldn't do. So the question now becomes, if this is the case, what about the people who are not married? Are they sinful? I mean, is nikah wajib for them? This is the question we need to ask. Or is it a sunnah, like in something if you should do because it's recommended? I mean, hands up who thinks it's wajib, that you have to marry. MashaAllah, the sisters, and some brothers. You're not shy. I tell you, a lot of sisters think it's wajib. So brothers, listen up, okay? There's wajib, yes? That's what they say. And who thinks it's sunnah? Obviously, the rest of you must think it's sunnah. Yes, mashallah. This is something that the scholars, they debated. They had a discussion over this. Because the whole purpose of marriage is to protect yourself, isn't it? Protect your private part and your gaze and so on. And to control your shahwat, your desires. It is to control all of these things. So the scholar said, for the one who's not able to do that, lower his gaze, mean to look down and not to want to fantasize about things like that, then for him, the nikah becomes wajib, obligatory. If you have people like this, and how will you know that there's a person like that in your community? What is the first sign for parents, do you think? What do you think the first sign for parents? Maybe we won't talk about what you see on the TV or magazines or something like that, but let's talk about the fact that he's pursuing to have a girlfriend. I mean, this person, if somebody has a girlfriend or so on, then usually what do the parents try to do? They try to get this person married off. I mean, this person cannot control his gaze and obviously cannot control his urge. So what do parents try to do? They try to take him abroad or something like that. Take him away from a haram environment and get them married. I mean, this is a sign that this person needs to get married. Needs to get married. So Islam says for this person who cannot lower their gaze and who cannot control their urges and their desire, we need to try to get them married. Now you might think, oh, this is something natural for the youth. Yes, it is natural for the youth. It's natural for any human being. But that's why the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlighted this. Said, for those of you who are young, if you can marry, then get married. Means there's some hikmah behind this. There's some wisdom behind this. And that's what we find when we look to the history again and civilization. What do we find? People used to get married younger, did they not? Get married very young. That's why it doesn't surprise me when we see something on TV. We see, what do we see? We see a six-year-old girl, she goes to carry water. She's helping out. She goes to carry water for a family from the third world. Or she's in the kitchen and she's helping out cooking. See, sometimes that's portrayed to us to say, look, oh, poor child, yes? Because of the hardship that child's going through. But if you looked at it from another perspective, it could be that this child has been brought up to be responsible, cares about the family, wants to participate. She hasn't got the distraction of DS or Nintendo or PS3. Though we need that in this today's society. Trust me, I've got, mashallah, 4 children. You need that. Sometimes they have a breather. But what I'm saying, that child, we say pity on her and say, oh... But it's not like that. That child, that's normal. There's no hardship on the child at all for that. Though we want to ease the situation. Rather than walk 2 miles to carry water, yes, we want there to be a tap outside the house or within the house and so on. We want to have proper gas supplies and so on to help them cook and so on. Yeah, this can make ease the situation. But in the end of the day, some children, they're very mature. So the Prophet ﷺ knew this and said, so what should we do? We should facilitate for our young. And let's bring it back to the society where today, facilitate for our young to get married. Why? Because you protect their deen. That's what the marriage is. Marriage is half your deen. Half your deen. Half of you are practicing how to find a wife. Half of it then what? Once you got your wife, to fear Allah and how you treat her and so on. So that's why this hadith, أَتَزَوْجَ النِّسَاءَ فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّةِ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي, I marry women, and whoever does not do this is not from me. How do we understand this? In which context? See, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, people wanted to find ways of being pious. So some people, they said that what they will do is they will shun sleep. So through the night, all they'll do is pray. And it's very difficult, isn't it, in this day and age? I mean, this is one of the most virtuous things that we can do, but we find very few Muslims practicing, staying up through the night. Okay? And if they are staying up through the night, it's not praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's going to be those PDA devices taking up all their time. Okay? So, some people said, this virtue is we're going to stay up through the night. Other people, they said, we are going to shun women. Other people, they said that during the day, they're not going to eat food. Because people wanted to know how to draw close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam found out about this, what did he say? He said to the people shunning their sleep, he said, look, I'm someone who stays up through the night, but I sleep as well. But I sleep as well. I am someone that I fast, but I break my fast as well. And I'm someone who marry women. And what was this for? This for the one who wanted to shun the women. Because you find in Christianity, is celibacy not something virtuous? Is something virtuous, is it not? In Christianity, anyone who's a Christian, who's a believer, will realize that their priests and so on used to push this a lot. That to be celibate, to abstain from a relationship, like the woman is like the devil in disguise. This is how they used to portray it. This is something virtuous. But Islam said, no, it's not virtuous to abstain from women. Women is something that is natural for you to chase after, to want. It's part of your fitrah. But what we want is to regulate it, make it halal. That is what we want you to do. And we know this because the Sahaba, who could be more high in iman than the Sahaba after the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? See, when they went to battle, or they went to the battlefield and so on, and it would be 2-3 months journey. On one occasion, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, Ya Rasulullah, should we castrate ourselves? What does castration mean? Snip. I mean, should we do something to stop the urge? The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, no. What did the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam allow in that case, when they went for 2-3 months in battlefield? What did he allow, do you know? Marriage. Temporary marriage, muta. See, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, even in the time when they went off to go and conquer land, where they were away from their wives for 2-3 months, maybe 4 months, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the beginning, he said to them, no, you are allowed temporary marriage because it's part of the fitrah. So what he did, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said to them, look, you can go and marry a woman, and even if the dowry that she will accept is a piece of bread, as long as she accepts it, then what? Give it to her and you will be temporary married. But then after Islam became strong, after the 7th year, then this was something that was abrogated. But what did he want to retain throughout all of that period when Islam was growing? Not to lose this tradition. It's so important. It is so important. It's the tradition going back to the time of Adam alayhi salam. It is something that is part of our fitrah. Even at that time, the sunnah did not take this away from the companions. Subhanallah. You should say subhanallah. It's amazing, is it not? See, the sunnah has an answer for everything. So celibacy is not allowed. And this is what was meant. That whoever leaves marriage and wants to become a someone celibate, and sometimes we find these strange film stars and pop stars, you know, they've had so many partners in their life, and all of a sudden they go through a bad period and they become the most pious person under the sun. I've become celibate. It's just hard to grab more attention, subhanAllah. There's no sincerity behind that at all. Because it goes against the fitrah. So this is what we need to understand. So now the question becomes, after this, is what is the sunnah in looking for a spouse? And as I said, there are a few young brothers here, and I'm sure they came for this part of the talk in itself. And for those brothers looking for their second wives, I'm sure they're looking for that as well, inshallah. So the question is that it's commonly known that women are married for what reasons? Four reasons. You know this, brothers, tell me, inshallah. What are the four reasons women are married for? Lineage, yeah? Nisabiha, yeah? For her lineage. What else? Deen, yeah? Your religion? Deeniha? Anything else? Limaliha, her wealth, and lijamaliha, mashallah. I know you know this, mashallah, okay? Because this is what the Prophet ﷺ said, that when men, they look for women, what do they go for? They go for this, yes? So that's why I'm not going to even talk about that anymore. What about women when they look for men? Do women look for men? Is it allowed? See, the hadith gives you the impression that it's only men that go out looking for women. It is not just the case. Men, they do go out looking for women. It's the most honorable thing to do. Because woman is ibd in Islam, is honor. She's protected. When she's with her guardians, protected in the house. She only goes out for haja, a need. She will only go out if there's a need for her to go out. So the men have the more opportunity to go and inquire with who? Wali Amr, the girl's guardian, whether it be the parents, brothers. We mean he has more chance to know in circles. So we'll inquire, and that's how they will go about finding. So that's why men, they choose women because of their wealth. So if you're someone wealthy, you know if he's got a daughter, then you're looking at the wealth that this person has and so on. And that's how men go and introduce themselves and find women. But let's look to the time of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. First and foremost, his first marriage, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was to who? Khadija. You know who proposed? The proposal came from Khadija radiallahu anha. It came via her friend Nafisa, who went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who was only just a merchant at the time, and looked to how they inquired. She said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who actually wasn't a prophet then, he was just Muhammad ibn Abdullah, she said, how would you like it that there was a beautiful woman, one of the wealthiest women in this city? How would you like it if she was to come to you? Beautiful woman, she's wealthy, she was to come to you of good lineage and ask you for marriage. What would you say? He said, who would want me like that? This is what he thought. Because he's an employee. He's not one of those people from the dragon's den, mighty power and that, nothing like that. In his own society, he's someone working for a woman. Then she said, how would you like it if I was to say that this person is none other than Khadija herself? May Allah be pleased with her. The Prophet ﷺ said, how can Khadija want to marry me when I know many of the wealthiest men in Mecca and from around the Arabian Peninsula have already asked for a hand in marriage? Meaning, it's like a joke. It seems funny, strange. Rich men who have everything they can offer to this woman who's already wealthy, and she's rejecting them left, right, and center because she's beautiful as well and she wants me. She said, and it is true. Nafisa said, as it's true, because I'm bringing you the proposal. How was it conducted? The Prophet ﷺ, after that is the proposition, yes? Prophet ﷺ sends his uncle to speak with her uncle to arrange the marriage. Now the marriage has a dowry. The marriage has even a khutbah to nikah. A khutbah nikah, meaning a sermon, giving some advice. Who is it that conducts this sermon? Do you know? Let's see how much we love the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how much we studied seerah. Who conducted the akad nikah? Sisters? Abu Talib. Amika, you said that, mashallah. Abu Talib, who is that? The uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He gave a khutbah. Do you know why he gave a khutbah? He said, we give a khutbah because this used to be the tradition of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Subhanallah. The khutbah comes from who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. So he gave, alhamdulillah, amma ba'd. Praise to Allah, amma ba'd. And then he gave some sincere advice. Now, the reason I mention this is because, is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam Muhammadur Rasulullah then? He's not. He is not Muhammadur Rasulullah even then. He's Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Qurayshi. Yes? From the Habashi tribe. Al-Arabi. This is who he is. But look to the tradition. Allah kept that. The tradition of what? The offline acceptance. The tradition of waliyama, to have a guardian. The tradition of people witnessing a khutbah. The khutbah itself. The dowry, and even the walima. Is there anything different in our marriages now? Is there anything extra we need to add? No. Limousine is an innovation. To have a stage innovation, all of this is innovation. You know, if it's within your capability, no harm in this. In Islam, we don't like extravagance. But if you have the capability, no problem. But can you see the main core basic elements of marriage is there? Even from when? Before the Prophet ﷺ became the Prophet ﷺ. Kept, retained. Because these honorable things that were happening. So just to show you that even before Islam was declared to the people, the Rasul ﷺ kept that tradition. Let me give you another example, and this is another good example. When the Rasul ﷺ is in Medina now, and a woman comes. A beautiful woman comes up to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She comes and she said to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Alaka bi haja. Alaka bi haja. Anyone speak Arabic here? Alaka bi haja. Is that, do you have any need for me? She went to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, Ya Rasulullah, do you have a need for me? And do you have a need, haja, for me? And she just stood there. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at her at a glance and he didn't respond. So the woman, what she did, she just sat down. She sat on the floor. She wasn't going to go. Because this woman wants to get married. So, Anas radiallahu anhu, he narrates this, and his daughter is there. Anas is one of the great companions, the one who was the khadim, the servant of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I mean, only a young lad. He's relating this many years later to the people, because ahadith, the tradition of hadith, narrating what he saw. So Anas's daughter is there as Anas is relating to people, and she goes, what a shameful woman. So Anas turns around as he's trying to give this narration, and he said, you know, this woman is better than you, because she saw khair and she went after it. She saw goodness and she went after it. She's better than you. So Anas corrects his daughter's opinion. Aisha, when she heard about this situation, she goes, this woman has no shame whatsoever. Then Allah revealed the verse to the Prophet ﷺ, if you want to marry them, you can marry them. And if you want to postpone them, postpone it. The verse revealed from Allah Azawajal, to which Aisha says, I see that your Lord rushes to please you. We're supposed to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but Allah rushes to please the Messenger Muhammad ﷺ. So on this occasion, what happened? The Prophet ﷺ had no need. But this woman, she just sat there. So one of the companions, one Sahabi who was there, he said, Ya Rasulullah, if you don't have a need for this woman, love for your Muslim brother, what you love for yourself, if you don't have a need for this woman, because she said, Alaka bi haja, do you have a need for me? Rasulullah said, why don't you marry me to her? So the Prophet actually did say to this Sahabi, he said, what do you have in way of offerance of dowry? Because if the Rasulullah was to marry this man, whoever he is, to this woman, would she accept? She will accept. Why? In obedience to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And obedience to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is obedience to who? Allah azza wa jal. How to please Allah azza wa jal is to be obedient to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't just say, khalas marry, you're married. No, he said, what are you going to offer? Because he is now what? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wali. Wali amar. There is no nikah in Islam except there is a wali. A guardian. Because the guardian looks out for the interests of the woman. He said, what do you have to offer? So he went to the house and said, I couldn't find anything of any value to offer. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to this man, do you have an iron ring? A metal ring? We're not talking about gold or silver or diamonds and things that women want, metal. He went back to his house, his companion. He looked at me and said, I don't even have a metal ring. So the Rasulullah said, what do you have to offer? He looked and he went, my izar. The Rasulullah said, you have no rida, mean no upper garment, just your lower garment. He goes, yes. He goes, just this. He goes, if you were to wear this, then she's uncovered. Okay? And if she's to wear this, then you're uncovered. So it doesn't benefit anyone. The man, he now sat down. Like this. The woman is waiting there. No one to marry her. He's like this. And then he decides, nothing for it. I'm going to walk off. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam calls him back. And he says, how much Quran do you know? He said, I know this surah. I know this surah. And this surah. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I now marry you. The nikah is done there and then. I now marry you to this woman for the fact that you will teach her those surahs, these chapters that you learn. You are now husband and wife. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. The funny thing is, whenever they make mention this hadith in any of the texts, the names aren't mentioned. Does anyone know the names? Okay, inshallah. I'm not going to tell them. You'll have to ask me Q&A. Because it needs more explanation, inshallah. Okay, so this show, but the thing is, the moral of the lesson, can you see how simple marriage is? That's, and obviously just to show that we live in a society now with lots of taboo, yes? There's lots of taboo, yes? A woman can't go and get married to a man and ask and so on. Divorced women can't get married, so on and so on. Women who have children from previous marriage, so on and so on. Widow can't get married. We put so many different barriers. Whereas we see, if we look to the tradition of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what do we find? What do we find? We find that marriage was something very simple. Very simple. So inshallah, that was some advice for the brothers who are single and the sisters who are single as well. Just to show you that if you really, really follow the sunnah, then your life will become ease. Okay? The only thing I would say for advice for them is that your standards, the standards that you have to be realistic. If they're not realistic goals, then you're not going to ever meet them. That's what you got to understand. It has to be realistic. And then as long as you keep it within that realm, then alhamdulillah, Allah will make it easy, because you're trying to fulfill the sunnah, and the sunnah is in obedience to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to be in obedience to the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in obedience to who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah always makes things easy for His servants. Remember this, inshallah ta'ala. Some advice now, inshallah ta'ala, for our married brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala. And inshallah, we're going to conclude with some points, inshallah ta'ala, because it's important for us to take away something from this, inshallah ta'ala, today. And the first thing you need to understand is that, like anything, there's principles, there's foundations and so on, that everything has to be taught and everything has to be learned. It's important for us to understand. Just like when we want to practice our deen, when it came to salah, namaz, I mean, can you remember the person you learned your salah from? Can you remember anybody? Was it the Mawlana at the madrasa? Was it your parents? Was it an uncle? I mean, you learned from someone, didn't you? You did learn this from someone. Because you have to learn it, because it's Islam in the end of the day. No one is born with a silver spoon of Islam in their hand. Everything you have to learn from your environment, somebody has to teach you. Just like that, marriage is the same. Yes, we see people around us married and so on, and we see them getting on with life, and they have married life, and we see, for example, children being born and so on. But that's not to say that they know how to do it properly. Going back to the analogy of Salah, how many times have you stood up in Eid Salah, yes? And Eid Salah comes around how many times in the year? Twice, only twice. So what can happen is you can forget that, can't you? Have you ever noticed people who come to Eid Salah and the Imam says, today we have what? Extra takbir. Okay? Now, usually these people, they get the first takbir right, because what they're doing, they're following the people. Because we have the extra takbir, what is it? Allahu Akbar, and people are raising their hands and so on. They usually they get away with that one. But then the second one, okay, they don't. They forget that and they go straight into ruku. They go straight into ruku. And then you think, oh my God, this man, he doesn't know the ahkam of salah. Can you see? So ahkam, ruling, is so important for us. So just like that, many people, they can make out they're getting on with their marriage and their marriage is going well. But really, are they following the sunnah? Are they following stuff that they learn? Do they know what to do in what situation? So that's why I'm going to just give you some golden advice, brief advice, maybe take 5 minutes, inshallah ta'ala, and then we open up the floor for Q&A, inshallah ta'ala. First and foremost, one of the things we need to understand, we live in a society now where there is status quo, there's position. Man does this, woman does this, and so on and so on. And it's become very, very distinct. Okay? Very distinct. But one of the things that modern society tries to do is to say that man and women are equal. And when you say men and women are equal, it doesn't mean in the sense that man and women have rights and they should be equally respected. It means they wanted man and woman to do the same role. Now, is this practical? You know, from a physical sense, yes, we're quite similar. But is this practical that man and woman do the same thing? Now, some people say no. People in modern society, they say yes, man and woman can do exactly the same thing. Okay? I'll give you an example why. Only recently I read an article of two people, they're non-Muslim. They are going to the courts. Why? Because they're a woman and a man. What do they want? They don't want a marriage contract. They want a civil partnership contract. What does that mean, even civil partnership contract? Anybody? No. Civil partnership means you're married. But what does it mean? MashaAllah. Don't be shy to say. Civil partnership was something that the government came up with. Okay, not to worry about legislation. I'm not going to harp on about legislation. But the principle, listen. Civil partnership came up because people of the same sex, they wanted to get married. So man and man wanted to get married. Woman and woman wanted to get married. And they wanted to have a similar rights from the society. Benefits and so on. And government, that they're treated like man and wife. But they're not. Because they're not a man and a woman, are they? They're man and man or woman and woman. But in this country, they allowed it from 2005. But this couple, they went to the registry office and they said, we want a civil partnership. The registry office goes, hang on a minute, you're a man and a woman, you have a marriage contract. They said, we don't want a marriage contract. But they said, but for people like you, man and woman, we already got something in place. Man does this, woman does this and so on. They said, no, we don't want that type of contract because we see it as something old fashioned. The woman, she says, look at this contract, this marriage contract. It gives women certain roles, men certain roles. Till death do us part. Woman has to protect herself. She has to do all of these things. This is old-fashioned. We don't want those values. We want to be treated as partners, yes. People. We want people to know that we're together. But it's not husband and wife. Not like the wife serves the husband or the husband protects the wife. We don't want none of those qualities. So they say we see each other as co-equal in everything. Now, this may sound nice, and people who are inclined from a feminist angle, where they want women not to be downtrodden and so on, they may see this as something enticing. But what did I say in the beginning of the talk today? I said, you hold on to the book of Allah, okay? Why the book of Allah? Because Allah, He created us, He knows our nature. And you hold on to the Sunnah is guidance, what will you find? You will find sukoon. You will find tranquility. And that's why Allah Azza wa Jalla, He sorted out the status quo for us already. He said, "Ar-rijal qawwamuna 'ala an-nisa bima faddala ba'dahum 'ala ba'd." MashaAllah, brother knows. You may have heard this in your own nikah when you got married. The men, they have authority over the woman because of what? Bima faddala ba'dahum 'ala ba'd. Because of the fact that Allah, He preferred one over the other. In what sense? Man, he has authority. Why? Because man, Allah generally created him stronger, but He gave him a different role, a role to be out in society, to go and earn, to work, to be in environments that a woman shouldn't necessarily always be in. See, a woman, she goes out for need because she's honor, she's protected. She doesn't ever want to be in a situation where her honor is violated in any way. So Allah looked to this. Allah gave a woman such a status that she has honor, respect, and the man, he can put himself in a situation. But then he can protect himself. He can look after himself. He can do certain things himself. So Allah said to the man, you have the role now. You go and win the bread. You go and do the things to protect this woman who is honor for you. So the man has been given authority. Now, what I'm saying is that when we have a relationship where we don't recognize this at first, that the man has been given authority, because women start to think, oh, he's going to abuse me, he's going to abuse me, and so on. We say, no, this is wrong. If a man ever does this, then he's doing wrong. He's only been given this charge because of what? Bima anfakum min amwalihim. Because they spend off their wealth on you. So the man is the one who will do this, and that's why in marriage, to start off any marriage, if we understand that sort of position, then we won't fall under the traps of these people who want to make this modernistic world where everything is hunky-dory, PC correct, and so on and so on, and everyone is equal like that. When Allah, He didn't do that to us. Allah, rather, He gave us certain rights, and what you should declare from your marriage is those sort of things. Inshallah ta'ala. Well, inshallah ta'ala, there's a couple more points I want you to mention, inshallah ta'ala. Just quickly about the issue of the married couple. So this one of the first things you need to understand is that the man, he should be someone who is actually of authority. Now, this would mean that the man himself is someone who takes charge of the house. Quite often what we do is that we look at our family and we think just because we're bringing the money in, we don't want to be involved with anything else. So what we find is that when it comes to kids' education, who's looking after that? It is the wife. When it comes to paying the bills and so on, I mean, sorting things out, who is it? It is the wife. So what we tend to do is a lot of our responsibility we pass on to the wife. So don't do this. Be men who are charged. Take hold of your household. Run it properly. And then you see, inshallah ta'ala, there will be sukoon in your family. The second thing we need to understand is that for those who are married, the most important thing, and we find this from the lessons of Adam and Eve, is that you need to have social communication. It is so important for you. Allah said, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مُوَدَّ وَرَحْمَةً. And we put between husband and wife, مُوَدَّ. What is مُوَدَّ? Al-Wadud, what does it mean? Love. It means love. There should be love in the marriage. وَرَحْمَةً, mercy. It means compassion. That you look to each other with love, not with hatred, and you have mercy. That you're easy going with each other. You've got to be easy going with each other, because this is the essence of what marriage is. To love each other. Now, as soon as you see yourself falling out of love with your wife, make excuse, rectify this. It doesn't help. Leading separate lives doesn't help you in any way. You think that's a solution, that I involve myself in this, and she involves herself in that, and you lead separate life. It doesn't. Where is the love? Where is the compassion? Where is the understanding? Where is this social connection that you're supposed to have? If you don't have that, I can guarantee problems. There will be problems there. And the last point I want to mention, and this is really summarizing it, and inshallah ta'ala, let's just try and take some what we can, inshallah ta'ala. But this is really summarizing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Hunna libas lakum wa antum libas lahum. They are garments for you, meaning the women, and you are garments for them. Means now this shows that the fact that the affection has to be that close, like a garment, they say. Like this jacket is close to me, that is how your relationship should be with your wife. And this verse was revealed about who? Companions. Who in the month of Ramadan, what did they do? They didn't know the ruling and the night time. Can they sleep with their wives? So what they did is they didn't dare ask the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in case it became something abrogated. You can't do this. So what they would do is they would cohabit in the night. Don't tell the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, do the ghusl and they're fasting for the day. But Allah is not shy to reveal this. So He mentioned this and said, tell the people, Hunna libastakum wa antum libastahun. They are garments, I mean the women, garment for the menfolk. And the menfolk are garment for the women. That's how close they should enjoy that companionship. They should enjoy that relationship. And Allah is not shy to mention this. So when you find problems in that department, you need to rectify this again. You need to rectify this again. Because the foundation of any marriage are based on just those three things. Good leadership, understanding of authority and so on, companionship, and then having what? Good relationships. Which is on an affectionate and a close nature. And if you do that, that is the secret recipe of marriage. You write this and put this away, mashallah. Every time you falter, just look at it again. Get back on track, inshallah. So this was just talking about the sunnah of marriage. Obviously a very big topic. I tried to give it in a concise manner, inshallah ta'ala, because no doubt it's something that will come up time and time again. You're married, yes, mashallah, but you need to get your brother married. Okay? Once your brothers and sisters are married, who needs to get married? Your children need to get married. This is something that will come up over and over again. Try to stick to the sunnah. What will happen generally as a society, the more we stick to the sunnah, the more we will find ease in our life and in society as well. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the understanding to understand the sunnah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it easy for us to practice this deen, and that makes us people who are holding firm onto the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the book of Allah azza wa jal. Wa quli qawli hadha astaghfir li wa lakum.
What can we say about them? And if, for example, in the modern day, maybe we don't have ulama like that, but if someone was to have that intent as to not marrying because of the sake of studies or any other curriculum, would they fall under that hadith that Fawwal is
meaning? I'll just ask a brief question. There's some scholars and some people who have studied or they didn't have the time to get married. or they were just too busy in their lives to get married, would they fall under the category of not being from amongst the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?
MashaAllah, JazakAllah for that question. Very good question, Muhammad. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. MashaAllah, I mean, this has been a point of discussion amongst many scholars of many generations. And quite often, what you find, those scholars, and I'm going to mention the names of some of them, inshallah ta'ala, who didn't practice marriage, those who didn't like them, one of the easiest way to attack them was to say, why didn't they get married? Now, let's look to just some scholars that the brother mentioned. If I mention from the earlier generation, we find Ibn Jarir At-Tabari. Who is At-Tabari? Anybody know? Not just hadith narrator, he's a muhaddith and mufassir. He's got the biggest, he made one of the biggest collection of tafsir of the Quran. Every verse he gave the explanation of this. To which we find the mukhtasar of this today, the summary of this today, Ibn Kathir, tafsir Ibn Kathir, which in itself is how many volumes? 10 volumes. So he made, that's a summary of what Ibn Jarir At-Tabari he did. His volume is much more. Okay, let's talk to about Ibn Taymiyyah. Rahmatullah. He had Al-Majmu'ah, a fatawa, which is a collection of what? 37 volumes. That's just Majmu'ah, because he did many other things. He did many other things, like Al-Aqidah Al-Wasatiyah, and many other short treatises. But he's got works. Imam Nawawi, what did he do? Do you know what Imam Nawawi did? He did the Sharh of Sahih Muslim. Sahih Muslim, which is a hadith collection. We're not talking about Muhtasar. We're not talking about the shortened version, which two volumes in a half. We're talking about the actual collection. He did a sharh of this, commentary on that. Okay, as well as Riyadhus Salihin al-Arba'in and so on. Now, I want you to mention their works. The reason being, you've got to understand, the purpose of marriage, relating back to the hadith, is that you lower your gaze and you protect your private part. Okay? These scholars, we can make excuse for them because of what? They were distracted, in a good way. If you imagine the amount of work that they produced, you can see where most of their time was. They didn't have time to go and browse on the internet or to walk along the streets and get their attention taken away like that. They were constantly in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, collating work and so on. These, it's hard to say and to explain the type of people they are, but you're never going to find people like that again. It's like I remember one film there was about bodybuilding. I remember young age, everyone, you know, when you're youth, everyone wants to do a bit of bodybuilding. And one of the bodybuilders, he was from Europe and he wanted to get to America. And he said, it's like a place you never get there. It's to pump so much iron to get to America. I'm just saying that these people, you're never going to get there again. The likes of those people, you're never going to find a generation like that again. Because today we have too much distraction. Even when we're looking at Islamic site, we're distracted by something haram. And we say, astaghfirullah. They didn't have any of that. They were stuck with their books and their pen in their house. They did their work. They went and did their dars, their lessons, and they came back, they prayed, and they even did jihad fi sabilillah in their time. They're busy in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for them, there was no need for marriage. Because the purpose of marriage is to lower your gaze, protect your private part. Alhamdulillah, Allah made it easy for them because they were in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
My friend got married without a wedding because her father is dead and her brother didn't agree to the marriage, but to stop doing haram, she got married without the wedding. Is this valid? If not, then why not? Please explain. Plus, her brother didn't have any valid reason for refusing to get her married off with this brother.
Okay, mashallah. Alhamdulillah, salatu wasalam ala Rasulullah. This is the thing that even myself I faced when trying to conduct nikah. The people want to get married and so on. And obviously the woman, as the Rasulullah said, there is no nikah, la nikah, illa bil wali amr. Except that there is a wali amr, a guardian to give her away. There's no nikah. And that even means the woman who was previously married or divorced and so on, she still needs to have a wali amr for her contract, which means a guardian to give her away. She needs to have this. So how do we reconcile this situation? Firstly, I mean, whoever conducted the nikah has to be someone faqih. He needs to know the fiqh of conducting nikah. So you've got to think is, if you knew a situation like this where a woman, she wants to get married, her immediate family doesn't accept this. And there's no valid reason for this. And there is fitna unless these two people married. Then can this person not have approached them? And if after that, they approaching the family, they showed no valid reason, then he can, in his own capacity, knowing the situation, step in as a wali. I mean, she still can't get married. So the nikah cannot happen unless there is a wali. So you wonder, how was it conducted? If it was someone faqih, then maybe he should have said, I am nominating myself as your wali. and get the marriage done. So we need to look at it. This is a specific incident, isn't it? So we need to look at that. Maybe if the sister wants to speak in more detail, she can do. But usually we say these surah nikah, in essence, can go ahead, but it's hanging. It's not complete. It's not complete. It's hanging. It has to be completed once the wali has been appointed, and then the contract is complete. Okay, inshallah ta'ala, and Allah knows best.
Nice question. Can a sister marry a brother if her parents reject proposal due to his race, despite the fact that he's practicing? After trying to convince him several times, can she get someone else to be her wali?
It is a tough one, really, because what you got to understand is if a sister met a brother, and we got to understand in what capacity does she know him? Because usually, what you got to understand, the wali is there for your benefit. So he'll be able to do more search and so on in the person, okay? So usually the person is looking to the wali is looking to the deen of a person. Now the fact that you want to marry this person against your parents' wishes and so on means you have more knowledge around this person than the average woman would have. And how did you establish that? Okay, just because somebody has deen, if your wali has checked them out and so on and disagrees, then how is it that you have so much knowledge of this person? Now, maybe we can say that this person is known as a du'at, and somehow you managed to get the word to this du'at. Yeah, in that case we say fine. Then what it takes is someone to intercede on your behalf and explain to the family, you know, Islam says this and such and such. If the wali disagrees after that, remember, and the girl is adamant she wants to marry, then well, she can get married. Because there's not a valid reason given there. But it has to be explained to the family. It has to be explained. But what I need to answer and understand is how is the sister so determined? Because you've got to understand, wali is not doing something bad for you generally. It's looking out for your interest. It should be. So if there is this conflict, maybe have a discussion with your wali. You understand? One of the things you've got to understand is not everyone is of the same level of Islam. And I know sometimes we're vehement in trying to practice Islam. So what we say is, yeah, Islam says the boom, boom, boom. But the thing is, have you even tried to explain this to our parents? Break down some of the cultural barriers that are there. You know, the barriers are there, yes? Do you understand? Because what I find, what generally happens is this. People will get married, they have every right to do, and then they're suffering conflict for many years. Many years, okay? And then what happened? Somebody had to come and explain to the parents in more detail, and so on. And then what will happen? It goes away. But people, because they want to just follow the sunnah, so it's fitna for me. What about fitna for the family? No, it's just fitna for me. They want to just do this, instead of getting people to mediate and so on. Try to resolve this and so on. Get people who can explain this and so on. And then that can happen. I'll give you an example. It happened to me. People came and approached me. They're not from my cultural background. They came and said to me, Akhi, I want to marry this sister. I said, fine. I said, you've got to give me a bit of time to facilitate it. I will do it for you, inshallah. Some people said to me, Akhi, you don't follow Islam. I said, you just told me today you want me to get you married tomorrow. And this happened. Yeah? I said, no, just leave it with me. Okay, and then what happened? Both these people got married. In the end, the marriage happened. Khalas, no bitter fighting or so on and so on. It just took me a bit of while to explain. Break down the cultural barriers. Break down the jahiliyyah and so on. Explain to the people. It's going to happen if you like or not. There's a certain way you do it. You explain, break it down. But when you force it upon people, because suddenly, all of a sudden you're on Quran and Sunnah, it becomes very hard on the family. But to those brothers who said, oh, don't follow Sunnah, I said, I do follow Sunnah. I facilitated it. It happened. So maybe we need to look at the hikmah doing things. Yes, there's an urgency to get married, but look at the hikmah behind doing this. But I, just for, as a footnote, I don't believe in the fact that we should have these sort of cultural backgrounds because this is from Jahiliyyah. We shouldn't intermix marriage. We should not look to these sort of things. But in the end of the day, what we need to do is we've got to realize as a society, we are still living in a lot of ignorance. We need to bring people out of this. We need to bring people out of this. And inshallah, ta'ala, Allah knows this. Allah make it easy for these people. Inshallah.
What would be valid reasons for parents to refuse to give their daughter hand in marriage?
Okay.
Especially for someone from a different race or different
culture.
What would be a valid reason for?
Yes. I was asking, what would be a valid reason for a parent to refuse marriage, especially if it's to do with race?
Yes.
Permitted or not?
MashaAllah. There is nothing allowable from the issue of race. There is absolutely nothing from Islam. Islam doesn't stand for this, that you say because of race. Now what you can do is say that there's not a valid reason. You can say the problems, because you have to be honest that there will be a problem. If you marry someone from this culture, then basically your mother cannot mix with so on. It's not a valid reason, but you have to take that into consideration. Usually you find even our societies, okay, Somalian, Bengali, Pakistani, Turkish, Arab and so on, they don't mix. Yes, we were one nice ummah, but we don't mix at all. We don't have anything to do with each other. We have our own cultural practices, our own food, the way we dress, even how we view marriages should be. I mean, I've been to Egypt, and this is where they send Qura, Hufaz of the Quran, and if you find the Farq, which is the parties that they have, you think, what is a disco? Okay? So there are lots of different practices. Okay? So what you have to understand is that, yes, you marry for the sake of fulfilling your sunnah and so on, but you find that the families very rarely will ever mix, because there's so much barrier. We haven't done our work. We haven't really mingled at all. So Arabs, non-Arabs, Somali, even Nigerian, you'll find, as we are our own pocket communities still. So in other words, what you're doing, when you understand what you're doing, when you say, I want to marry this brother from this, you're saying in effect, I'm going to be in exile. Because you're going to find those families are not going to mix. So it's not valid reason, but I'm saying this is what is coming into the mind of those parents. Because as communities, we are not cohesive at all. We like to put this front, and mashallah, today we have a very mixed crowd. Because you're here for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as communities, we haven't mixed. I know, because I live in the community. I speak to people in the community. And every mosque you go, you know what type of mosque it is. It's a Bengali mosque, it's a Pakistani mosque, it's a Nigerian mosque. We still got our own communities, and we don't mix at all. So that's the thing. So usually the parents, they're not looking at the fact that that you're going to be treated bad or anything like that. It's just a case of, we're not going to be able to mix. And that's really, in other words, what I'm saying is goodbye to you. And that's not the loss that they feel. It's usually no more than that, the fact that the community. But normally what should we do? We shouldn't look to these things. We shouldn't look to these things. But I'm just giving it because of the fact that I'm in the community. I know what the community feels like and how the community works. That is usually why the reservation is there. But truly what should happen is people should come, and we should, as a community, try to get to know each other better. Try to remove these barriers. That's what we should do. And that's why you would get closer to the sunnah. So to answer your question, there is no excuse, except for the fact that this person may not be able to look after her. May not be able to protect her. The nafaka is not there. Food, clothing and shelter. In this case, you don't have to give to this person. Because your guardian, the other person, has to be able to guard. That's what it has to be. It's not that fact of the colour, of the skin, or the language, or anything. It has to be the fact, is that person going to be now the person who's going to mahram, look after this person? If not, then obviously we have to choose someone else better.
What should parents do if their children have a boyfriend or a girlfriend?
What should parents do? They shouldn't do what that happened in Canada recently. Did you follow that case in Canada? The Afghani people? Don't follow news much. Did you hear what happened? A man, he had three daughters, they had boyfriends. What did he do? He killed them. How did he kill them? He drowned them first. He drowned them in whatever, bathtub or something first, stuck him in a car, then pushed it into a canal. Now, I want to mention this, why? Because when they did the autopsy, they said, these people, they didn't just drown in the car. It's not like in a fit of rage, he pushed them off the side of the road, though he used his own car to ram this car. He said, it looks like they've been asphyxiated before. They've been killed before, okay, put in the car, then pushed into the canal, and to make it look like they were drowned in that accident. And they said, no, it can't be, because the car window was open. How can it be that these people drowned when the car window was open? No, so we don't go to that extreme. If we find out that our children have boyfriend or girlfriend, we don't have this mentality of honor and all this so and so and so. No, what we've got to understand is what caused them to get to that situation. Okay? I'll give you an example. Boyfriend or girlfriend, or not to pray, which is worse? To have a boyfriend or girlfriend or not to pray, which is worse? Not to pray. We say that, don't we? But what would upset us more? What upsets the parents more? They don't pray or nothing, they don't fast and so on. But they have a boyfriend, girlfriend, what do they want to be? They want to kill him. Literally, we want to kill him. What we need to understand is what caused them to go to that stage in the first place. Did you even speak to them? Did you, as they grew up, for people to explain the issue of tamayyiz, distinction, and what would happen, and what we have in our culture, and what it means, and why we don't have boyfriend, girlfriend? Did you even do any of that? No. You just let them go because you wanted them to have education. They came back with the education, but they also came back with what the society has. Now, you can't blame society. This is how people live. We're not going to impose Islam on people if they're not Muslims. That's how they live. That's how they live, isn't it? Boyfriend and girlfriend is halal in the religion. So we can't blame them. But the fact is, you should have brought them up on Islam. So what do you do if you find out, you explain to them? You explain to them what they're doing. It's not right. And we know that you have every right to get married and so on, and you have every right, but can you wait for the time? At least get to the point where so-and-so has happened, or you're mature, or so on and so on. Explain to them, be with them, work with them. But to have this attitude that your honor is gone and so on, and do something crazy like this man, or to have that sort of thing where you lock them up and so on, this is not from Islam either. It's not from Islam. Not from Islam. So what should we do for these people? We need to find out what went wrong, backtrack a bit, go on and so on, try and build a relationship. Just you having a go at them, locking them up, taking away their rights and that is not going to help in the situation. We've seen this time and time and time again, and unfortunately we can't learn from this even yet. And Allah knows best.
شراب الحب يعرف بالمذاق وما كل السقاة له بساقي